It gives me great pleasure to introduce the chair for the next session. This is Peter George, our clinical lead in the interstitial lung disease and sarcoidosis unit at the Brompton. He has transformed our unit, which is now, as traditionally been consultant led, but it is more than ever patient centered. Peter, over to you.
Thank you, Vasilis. Thanks for your kind words. And thank you to yourself and Sarcoidosis UK for what is turning out to be an absolutely amazing day. Huge number of patients, fantastic speakers. We're really, really fortunate to have this opportunity. And I'm really excited to be chairing this session, which is around specific challenging forms of sarcoidosis. And when we think of those challenging forms of sarcoidosis, really, one of the areas is cardiac sarcoid. And we're extremely fortunate through Vasilis and Dr. Rakesh Sharma to have one of the leading cardiac sarcoid services in the world in terms of expertise and numbers. So I'd like to introduce them both to you and then let them get on. So as you know, Dr. Vasilis Kouranos is a respiratory consultant in the interstitial lung disease and sarcoid service. He really is the lead for our sarcoid service and has been the mastermind of this wonderful day. And Dr. Rakesh Sharma, who's a highly experienced consultant cardiologist who leads the cardiac sarcoid service at the Royal Brompton Hospital. And between Rakesh and Vasilis, they really have built up, along with Athol Wells, a formidable partnership looking after some of the most complex cases. So I'd like to hand over to you both for a presentation titled Cardiac Sarcoidosis Presentation. Is this different to other forms of the disease?
So thank you very much, Peter and Vasilis, for the kind introduction. Just to echo what's been said, I'm most grateful to Sarcoidosis UK for putting this fantastic program together. And it's a true privilege to speak to patients in this forum. So I'm going to share the screen so that we can go through the slides. So hopefully you can see my slides. So the course of the next 30 minutes, Vasilis Kouranos and I will be talking to you about cardiac involvement with sarcoidosis. We'll try and keep the number of slides to a minimum just to allow time for questions and discussion. But essentially what we're going to talk about is why it's important to make an accurate diagnosis early and how we can achieve that, and also how we can engage with our patients to try and learn from them and to try and provide a good service in terms of cardiac sarcoidosis. So you would have heard from our colleagues already that sarcoidosis is a multi-system disease. And in fact, the most common organ which is affected is the lung. And this is why many of the speakers today come from the respiratory department. Having said that, when there's cardiac involvement, this is when patients can present with potentially life-threatening issues. And as a result, it's very important as doctors that we try and educate our colleagues on how to try and make the diagnosis early on to try and protect patients and actually to try and prevent serious problems down the line. Now, this is a rather medical slide, but I'll talk through the key principles. As you've heard from other speakers today, we know that sarcoidosis is an inflammatory condition. So what that means is that the body's immune system is actually working against itself. And as a result of this inflammation, tissues can become swollen, and there's a process known as edema, which can form in different parts of the body. So certainly if there's edema and inflammation in the heart, then this can lead to serious sequelae. And one of the main ways in which patients can present with the first episode of symptomatic cardiac involvement is through heart block. So this is when patient's conduction system becomes involved and the patient can sometimes even collapse or have other problems. One of the key factors about diagnosing cardiac involvement is that we want to try and halt this inflammatory process early to try and prevent the edema and ultimately to try and prevent fibrosis, which is a scarring process in the heart, which if left unchecked can lead to heart failure. So how, as a patient, may you know if there is cardiac involvement? Well, many of our patients who refer to the service actually may not have any symptoms at all. And we often get referrals from our respiratory colleagues to the cardiac sarcoidosis unit, where a patient with respiratory sarcoidosis has had, for example, an abnormal heart tracing, such as an ECG, or an abnormal heart scan, such as an echocardiogram. So once we receive these referrals, we would often initiate more advanced imaging tests. Cardiac MRI is a fundamental tool for diagnosing the condition, and in fact, there are many different indications for a cardiac MRI scan, and certainly these scans are now being performed all around the world and all around the country. And there are certain hallmark features on the MRI scan which may suggest that the patient may have sarcoidosis, even if there's no extracardiac known involvement. So MRI clinicians are actually referring patients to our service, even when patients themselves may not have symptoms. But clearly, patients can also develop symptoms if there's cardiac involvement, and the symptoms can vary between palpitations, dizzy spells or fainting if the patient's had conduction block, but also in more advanced cases, if the patient's developed heart failure, then they can become breathless and sometimes develop signs of fluid accumulation. So how can we make the diagnosis? Well, with cardiac sarcoidosis, because there's no single test which can clinch the diagnosis, very often it feels like putting together different pieces of a jigsaw. And this is where we look at the patient's symptoms, their presentation. We would ideally like to get some tissue evidence of sarcoidosis, and most often this tissue may come from the lungs. We rarely biopsy the heart because very often we can miss the diagnosis because of the patchy nature of the condition. We also heavily rely on advanced imaging, so echocardiograms can give an idea that there may be some cardiac involvement, but it's really cardiac MRI and FDG PET which can give us a clue as to whether there's inflammatory processes going on and whether that inflammation is actually due to cardiac sarcoidosis. And clearly there are other tests which we will do to try and help support the treatment, but certainly it's about getting tissue diagnosis from outside the heart together with putting that information with advanced imaging modalities, like putting a jigsaw together to come up with the diagnosis. And we're heavily reliant on an MDT approach. MDT stands for multidisciplinary team meeting, because not one person can have all the skills necessary to try and manage patients with cardiac sarcoidosis. We really need a team-based approach. And since the MDT was first put together several years ago at the Brompton Hospital, we've completely revolutionized the way we diagnose and treat patients, and hopefully this has led to much better outcomes. So why should we approach patients in this way? Well, sarcoidosis is a relatively rare condition, particularly when it affects the heart. And so when it comes to a rare condition, in order to try and provide good treatment, we need to manage patients in centers where there's a high volume of patients being seen. Most cardiologists will see only one or two patients with cardiac sarcoidosis in a year. At the Brompton, we would see hundreds of patients with this condition. So that means that we do develop expertise and also can provide a more consensus approach to managing this condition. Another hallmark of sarcoidosis, particularly affecting the heart, is that it can mimic other conditions. And very often, there'll be a debate in our MDT meeting as to whether this is a high likelihood or moderate likelihood, or even a low likelihood of a patient having cardiac involvement. And this is just one example. It's a condition where there's change in the heart muscle and conduction, a condition called arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, which can sometimes mimic sarcoidosis. And again, it's about having the right people in the MDT to try and tease out what the most likely diagnosis will be. As I've already said, there's no single test which can confirm the diagnosis, which is why putting together all the pieces of the jigsaw is important. And patients may present with a variety of non-specific symptoms, and certainly we've also learned in our practice that even if patients have had a diagnosis of cardiac sarcoidosis and they're treated and the condition goes into remission, without careful follow-up and surveillance, some patients can relapse even without having symptoms. So this is where imaging is key. I also think it's very important to have an open mind when it comes to making a diagnosis. As I've shown in one of the earlier slides, there is a natural history of the condition. And certainly if a patient presents early on where there's no change on the imaging, but the patient then subsequently develops fibrosis, the condition may become more evident later. So in cases where the truly borderline criteria, we need to keep an open mind. This is a very busy slide, which I'm not going to go through, but just to say that we try and have a systematic approach for diagnosing patients, because without having a system in place, it's difficult to try and provide uniform treatment. And certainly this is a protocol which has been replicated in other centres, where we try and provide an evidence base to what we're doing in terms of tests and then diagnosis. Just a few words about treatment, because I think this is a whole different talk, but just to say that if patients do develop heart failure, which is where the fibrosis has led to impairment of cardiac contractility, then there are different drugs which are available to us to try and help improve the cardiac function, symptoms, and also ultimately prognosis. And as mentioned earlier, conduction system problems can sometimes manifest either with heart block or ventricular rhythm disturbances. And this is where device therapy is very, very important. We have different types of devices according to the patient's need. And very often these devices we will implant through a kind of minimal invasive approach. We're very lucky in our MDT to have arrhythmia doctors, implant pacemakers, but we also have electrophysiologists who will advise on ablation. So it really is a joined up effort to try and help provide the best treatment for our patients. So I think I'll stop there to allow Vasilis to talk about treatment in a bit more detail, and then I'll be available for questions.
Thank you, Rakesh. Let me share my screen. So, cardiac sarcoidosis is one of my main interests, and what I understood from the very, very first moment that I came to the Brompton was that an internal battle happening in A&E, but even behind the scenes between cardiologists and respiratory physicians, it gave place to a very strong collaboration between us. And I'm really proud about the development of the multidisciplinary team that I think is changing the field in the diagnosis and management of cardiac sarcoidosis. I will touch on the main challenges as far as I can think regarding cardiac sarcoidosis, and that includes the current poor screening strategies that are used across the world, different mode of presentation of the disease that is also posing diagnostic challenges. And many patients are trying to understand the predictors of outcome that would depend on the studied population. Unfortunately, we have lack of control data for effective treatment, and the main guide remains our experience. So I will just touch on the screening strategies, and at the moment, what is recommended is that the patients are asked about cardiac symptoms in every single visit, and if possible, perform an ECG in every single visit. That's not always the case, but at least symptoms can be obtained. And as you can see in this table, the cardiac symptoms offer a sensitivity of 65% and a specificity of 57%. They're not great, but they're actually catching up to 50% of the patients. The current guidelines recommend performing, obtaining symptoms and doing an ECG, which only increases the sensitivity from 65 to 69%. Whereas if everyone was performing an MRI, the overall sensitivity will be up to 97%. The reason for not performing this is A, for financial issue, reasons, and B, because even if cardiac MRI detects limited changes, it doesn't mean that the patient's outcome will change. So there is a lot of research going on at the moment to actually answer that question. It was mentioned to the previous session about the recommendation of how patients should be evaluated at baseline, and the top right table is actually showing what is currently recommended. And I use that to show that it's not different since 1999, and the patients are recommended to have cardiac history recorded and ECG. And if patients had cardiac symptoms or ECG abnormalities, they then move on to have a cardiac MRI or even a PET. Echocardiography is a tool that is more and more used at the moment. But again, this is not performed in all centers. What we need to be very careful about is the type of the symptoms and how long they last for, because any one of us has felt anxiety, any one of us has felt fear, and this causes palpitations. Interestingly, nowadays we have seen patients who developed cardiac manifestations, and one of the main things had been the atrioventricular block. And later on, they are found to have cardiac sarcoidosis, although in the beginning they were not suspected. This is one of the main reasons why our service has actually increased in capacity, because now cardiologists are aware that this entity exists. But that means that every patient who has an atrioventricular block below 60 years old, or even has VT or heart failure, should be checked not to have cardiac sarcoidosis. And this is a lot of work in progress and not of awareness to be raised. This is a busy table, but it actually shows how cardiac sarcoidosis is diagnosed, mentioned by Dr. Sharma. But the important bit to say here is that patients need to have extra cardiac biopsy. That is, as we heard earlier, is not always easy. It's not always obtained. They either present with heart failure, major arrhythmia, or signal on imaging like MRI and PET. But the key point is that in the guidelines, it is recommended that other diagnoses are excluded. And this is where the value of the multidisciplinary meeting lies. And this is what makes the difference in actual fact. Regarding the prognosis, patients with cardiac sarcoidosis, yes, they have a worse outcome compared to non-cardiac sarcoidosis patients. This has been shown and related to the fact that these patients have cardiac damage, as is represented on MRI, so they have a higher risk of sudden cardiac death, major arrhythmia, or even heart failure hospitalization. We don't know exactly what is the extent of the fibrosis that is associated with the worst prognosis. But what we do know now is that if you are diagnosed with cardiac sarcoidosis, and if you have left ventricular impairment, active inflammation, or at least high extent of fibrosis, this is associated with worse outcome. With regards to therapy, you have heard a lot, but sarcoidosis-specific therapy is what is used from the sarcoidosis specialist point of view, and we rely on cardiologist expertise for the antiarrhythmic and device implantation, as well as heart failure management. Again, these treatments integrate, and a multidisciplinary approach appears to become a gold standard approach, because one could ask which treatment should start first. One could ask, should I take cardiac medications instead of immunosuppression? And the answer is that a combination is the only way forward. What we are doing from a sarcoidosis perspective is that we want to evaluate whether there is cardiac sarcoidosis activity. We are very vigorous with treatment when active disease is identified, because we believe that this way we can eliminate or at least prevent disease progression. And we always evaluate our response before formulating a long-term plan. The monitoring is key with regards to the adjustment of sarcoidosis-specific therapy. And when it comes to cardiac sarcoidosis, the treatment, unfortunately, has to be prolonged. We are very much aware of the toxicity that steroids cause. And there are studies lately that have shown that. So we want to minimize their effect. But what someone needs to remember is that even when discontinuing treatment, patients are not safe. So even if they have no activity and we decide to discontinue treatment, which is what they would really want, there was a study that showed that there was a higher risk of mortality or decline in cardiac function. All of these would suggest relapse of their disease. So this needs to be carefully monitored. This is just an example of a patient that was given vigorous treatment, and you can see on the lower part the active disease that was evident in the heart and elsewhere in the body, and you can see the excellent response that the patient had afterwards. And I would, despite what has been discussed about the side effects, I would like to point out that this patient was treated with steroids, continued on steroids and methotrexate, and actually had his ejection fraction improved. So I think that despite a huge effort from both the clinicians and the patient's perspective, we did manage to improve his prognosis. As I mentioned, we are a very closely working team. It is patient-centered but consultant-led, and our key and core tool is the MDT approach. This is how patients look like after success and after complete resolution of their treatment, and this is what we would like to succeed for most of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vasilis. Would you mind sharing your screen? That's perfect. I don't know what to make of all those boxing references. You're obviously you're psyched up for the day, which is fantastic. And that was a wonderful talk from the both of you. So thank you very much. It stimulated a huge number of questions. Sorry, I'll start my video so you can see me. A huge number of questions, and we've got about 10 minutes to go through them all. So I'm really grateful to you both for that. A number of questions have come up about what patients need to be aware of in terms of symptoms. So when I reflect on my own practice, chest pain is quite a common symptom of sarcoidosis. What is it specifically that patients need to think about? And as clinicians, how can we direct them to the sarcoidosis, the cardiac service, when at the right time?
Thank you, Peter. Should I take this question, Vasilis?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. So when it comes to chest pain, obviously it's important to try and characterize the type of chest pain. If there's inflammation of the heart, a condition called myocarditis or even myopericarditis can develop. So that's when there's inflammation within the muscle and the membrane around the heart. And typically the chest pain tends to be worse on change in posture. It can be sharp. It can be worse if patients have a cough, for example. It tends not to be the type of chest pain that patients get with coronary artery disease, which is more like a pressure sensation on exertion, which goes away when patients rest. But having said that, not every patient fulfills the textbook descriptions. So I think if anyone is getting chest pains, they need to be reviewed by a specialist, and the standard tests such as an ECG, blood test, would be done anyway. But certainly in sarcoidosis, if there's inflammation of the heart, patients can present with chest pain. What we tend to find is that a more common symptom is actually palpitations. So very often patients will present with either skip beats or extra beats or even rapid heartbeats. And again, that could be due to inflammation, but it could be due to fibrosis as well. And for each patient, it's about trying to work out what's happening with the rhythm, because it could be benign rhythm or it could be something a bit more serious.
So the focus is really on chest pain, which is slightly different or changing, and palpitations. So your heart rate, being aware of your heart pumping, beating, and it doing so in a way which is not normal for you, and they would be concerning features.
Peter, I would like to add one more thing to Rakesh's comment. It's, and we have seen this increasingly nowadays, is that because of the ability of the MRI to detect cardiac involvement, we are now performing scans to patients who have disproportionate breathlessness. And disproportionate breathlessness would be defined as patients who have normal or normalist lung function that cannot really explain the degree of breathlessness that they feel. So we have identified that patients who previously were reporting breathlessness on exertion that could not be easily explained had cardiac involvement.
So breathlessness is a really important symptom, isn't it, in this context? A number of questions have come through surrounding whether, if a patient has been diagnosed, for example, with mediastinal lymphadenopathy, so enlarged lymph nodes in the chest and perhaps skin involvement, can they then develop cardiac sarcoid later on in their illness? And is that something they need to look out for?
Should I take this question first, Vasilis, and maybe you can add to it? So yes, sarcoidosis is a multi-system disease, and very often patients will present in either one of two ways, either because there's extra cardiac involvement, And the classic scenario is someone goes to A&E and has a chest x-ray that shows some lymph nodes in the chest to be enlarged, and then they have the test which show this cardiac involvement. But we also know there's a condition called isolated cardiac sarcoidosis. So this is where the condition for some reason is located just to the heart. And even though we look for extra cardiac disease, such as with a PET scan, we don't find any. So, and that can affect up to about a quarter of patients. So isolated disease we tend to find is a bit more difficult to diagnose. It does certainly warrant an MDT approach, and also the outcome, unfortunately, tends not to be as good as patients who presented with more systemic disease. Vasilis, did you want to add to that?
I think that this goes down to screening and whether, you know, how can we screen actually patients. I would be more happy to screen patients if they, for sarcoidosis, if they had a cardiac manifestation that is core, in the sense that they had a major arrhythmia or heart failure that they were not aware of. And this would be by performing a CT scan rather than a chest x-ray. And with regards to sarcoid patients, whether they, how they should be screened, I think that nowadays blood tests with biomarkers on top of ECG and Holter monitoring are really helpful. That's what I would say. I think because of the anxiety that cardiac involvement causes to patients, we just need to be mindful of being very accurate to what we are doing, rather than jumping and doing all sorts of tests that may not be needed and cause a lot of psychological distress too.
Yeah, no, thank you, Vasilis. So biomarkers are just blood tests which might suggest an underlying problem that can go up or down as that disease improves or gets worse. So it's just a way for us to monitor the activity of a disease using blood tests. We're obviously very, very fortunate at the Brompton to have a highly active transplant service. And I know that we've been working increasingly closely with our lung transplant physicians. We have weekly MDTs now, monthly MDTs, and are doing many more lung transplants, including for sarcoid. How about transplantation for cardiac sarcoid? What's your experience of that?
Again, should I start this list and hand over to you? So it's a very timely question, actually, because yesterday we submitted an abstract to the British Cardiac Society about our experience for cardiac transplantation for cardiac sarcoidosis. So we looked at the number of transplants which took place from 2010 to 2020, so over 10 years. And out of approximately 250 patients who were transplanted, there were 7 who had cardiac sarcoidosis diagnosed. And the unfortunate aspect is that even in the ones who had the transplant, there was apparently a relapse of 40% in the transplanted heart. So there's some process which is going on, which is driving this condition. And although transplantation is a very rare form of treating cardiac sarcoidosis, for some reason, in up to 40%, there is some relapse. So we don't really understand the mechanism for that. Vasilis, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, I would like to add that I think that we are actually fortunate to have a very limited number of patients who end up being on the transplant list or being transplanted, in the sense that we have seen good response to the therapies that we use. But on the other hand, I think that this is offered, and there is another new development that is quite commonly used nowadays, which is LVADs. These are new devices that the transplant physicians are using as a bridge to transplant, or even in isolation, to help patients that have severe heart failure go through the symptoms. So there are a lot of advances in that field. We try to keep our the options open for our patients, primarily because they are young and they are in an age group that would be candidates for it.
We have 1 minute left. I'm going to ask one final question. Rakesh, perhaps if you take this, what is the value of cardiac rehabilitation in improving ventricular function in patients with cardiac sarcoidosis?
Very good question. I think the answer is we don't know. In terms of cardiac rehab, we do use this for patients with heart failure, so we can extrapolate. And several studies have shown that if there is heart failure, patients do benefit. For the cardiac sarcoidosis population, there's no reason why that shouldn't apply as well. Certainly with COVID, there's been a huge impact on cardiac rehab across the country, and the services have been on been done remotely. So, but I think we do need proper prospective studies to answer that question properly.
And I suspect, watch this space, if anyone's going to do them, it'll be Dr. Sharma and Kouranos, who I'm sure will be leading on that kind of work. So I'd really like to thank you both for a wonderful presentation. Really, you've touched on a very difficult topic and simplified it for us. I think we will look forward to reading your slides back and taking their time to pour through them. So thank you both. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Christopher Atkins. Now, Dr. Atkins is a consultant in respiratory medicine at the Norfolk and Norwich University Hospital. He was a member of the BTS sarcoidosis statement, and he's an expert in fatigue relating to sarcoid. And this is an area that we know patients really struggle with. So I'm very excited to listen to you. So Christopher, over to you.
Thank you very much. I'll just try and share my screen here. Can everyone see my screen now?
Yes, we can.
Great. So firstly, I can only echo what the previous presenters have said in thanking the organisers and Sarcoidosis UK programme. I think it's been absolutely fantastic, and it's also brilliant to be able to talk directly to patients in Sarcoidosis UK. I'm recently appointed as a consultant. I was still a training registrar when I was on the BTS panel putting together the guidelines. So it's also a real honour to talk alongside the people who've been a real inspiration over the years in terms of how to manage sarcoid and how to treat patients in the way that I now do. With that in mind, my talk today is about managing quality of life in sarcoidosis and what to do. And this is a complete 180 from the previous talk, which obviously involves a lot of investigations that can definitively show whether or not cardiac sarcoid is present and interventions with robust evidence behind them. I don't really have that behind what I do, but as mentioned, my research interest for several years now has been about chronic fatigue and sarcoidosis and the other issues that affect quality of life. So I hope to be able to discuss something that might be of use to patients and perhaps colleagues as well. So I think it's important to start with what affects quality of life in sarcoid. It's easy to think about sarcoidosis as something that is a disease that just causes direct organ damage and dysfunction through the infiltration and deposition of granulomas that Simon spoke about this morning. And around this, we also find systemic symptoms that cause people to lose their quality of life. So fatigue, muscle weakness and pain, and small fiber neuropathy, which I'll come to as well alongside fatigue. And that these together reduce an individual's ability to perform activity, their so-called fitness. And so we treat with medications such as corticosteroids to try and dampen down the activity of the sarcoidosis, but this in itself carries a significant risk of treatment side effects, of which fatigue is most certainly one with corticosteroids, particularly high doses. And we refer to this bunch as the symptom burden. So all these are direct symptoms that occur. But how an individual then perceives those symptoms and is debilitated by those symptoms, or indeed not, is affected by further things. I should add that with the symptom burden, this then leads to disability, which is a loss or change of job or reduced activity. And someone asked, one of the questions is whether sarcoidosis is considered disability. And under the Equality Act in 2010, if you have a physical or mental impairment that has substantial and long-term negative impact on your ability to do normal activities, then yes, it is considered disability. So the answer is yes, it can be, depending on how it's affected you. And it's also important to note that certain manifestations such as cardiac sarcoid that was mentioned previously can in certain cases lead to death. But the burden of symptoms can be affected by further aspects, and so we know that anxiety and depression modify how we perceive our symptoms and indeed the world around us. And that's further affected by our symptoms are often impairing our normal ability to do activities, making us more isolated and losing social contact. And overall, this is the psychological burden. And together, these two things lead to an impairment of quality of life. And trying to tease apart which of these are the predominant problems and which of these we can do something about is part of the challenge in individual patient care. And it's why it's important to treat every patient with sarcoidosis individually. So what do we need to treat? Well, there's essentially two reasons, and that was this was mentioned by Professor Wells earlier, and I think he was being a little bit modest because this paper that I've taken a screenshot of refers to it specifically as Wells' law. And so there is the reason to treat because of danger to organs, and there is also the reason to treat because we want to try and improve an individual's quality of life. From that paper, these are the rough headings for why we treat. I'm going to remove eye problems from quality of life and stick that under danger for ocular disease. I'm going to take out calcium dysregulation, as I think long term that causes danger on multiple levels. I'm going to take out lung symptoms because we have discussed these before. And as much as I'd like to be, I'm not a dermatologist, so I'm not going to talk about cosmetically important skin lesions. So I'm going to focus on fatigue and small fiber neuropathy, which I think we should refer to as the awkward squad, because let's face it, they are difficult to treat. I'd like to briefly talk about small fiber neuropathy because I think it is important. It does lead to a number of symptoms that can cause problems. This is where small nerve fibers within the skin, the density of them become reduced. And so you can get various symptoms, most commonly probably shooting pains or sensitivity of the skin for no apparent reason. And that's from the loss of these fibers, which comes about not because the fibers themselves have been destroyed by the activity of the sarcoidosis, but more as a phenomenon around the immune activation. And it can cause a long and numerous list of problems. This is the small fiber neuropathy screening list, which is, has been validated for looking for small fiber neuropathy. But I don't like necessarily using screening lists, which are often more research tools than dealing with an individual patient's concerns. But it does flag up the kind of things that can be causing problems for an individual. Pains, shooting pains in the arms or legs, also things associated with the autonomic nervous system, which is the part of the nervous system that deals with the parts of the body which are under automatic control. So things such as bladder control, things such as swallowing. It can also lead to things such as palpitations, dizzy spells. So various other symptoms which can overlap with other true manifestations of sarcoid, even cardiac sarcoid, without any evidence of overt disease activity. Unfortunately, for some people, it is manageable. For some people, it can be very difficult to treat, but it's important to be aware that sometimes some of these symptoms can be managed with symptoms. And there is, this paper has summarized the treatments that have been trialed. Again, the evidence isn't always great, and it sometimes a case of trialing with an individual what works for them. But it's also important to recognize that these medications have their own significant side effects. And so working out whether the treatment is going to be better than the side effects it itself causes is something that has to be discussed individually. But I'm sure some people have been tried on drugs like amitriptyline, duloxetine, topiramate and lamotrigine and have had benefit from them because of these type of symptoms. However, I'd like to focus a little more on fatigue, and I could literally write a thesis on this. Fatigue is a big problem. This is the data from the British Thoracic Society's Sarcoidosis Registry. Some of the authors you'll recognise who've spoken earlier today or will be speaking later. And fatigue was number three in patients presenting to clinic with a diagnosis of sarcoidosis, and so new cases. And although this was only a small number of cases because it was quite early on in the registry, it was about a third of patients that were reporting fatigue. And I have to say that when I say reporting fatigue, I mean that the box was ticked on it by their physician that was entering them to the registry. And it's important to note that not everyone screens for fatigue as part of what's going on. So this may well be a slight underrepresentation, particularly when you consider looking at other evidence. And this is just one study, which admittedly was looking at something else, but had recorded fatigue in prevalent cases. So these are long-term cases of sarcoidosis. And as you can see, the lowest rate was 41.6% in patients that had purely extrapulmonary, so not really any evidence of lung sarcoidosis or predominantly abdominal sarcoidosis. 40% of those patients suffered significant fatigue to them, and all other clusters of manifestations of sarcoid, they were looking at two-thirds or above of those patients reporting fatigue. So it's a really common symptom, and it can really debilitate an individual. And it can sometimes be difficult to define. I think it's important to try and define what's fatigue and what's tiredness, and the two can often overlap, but they are different. Tiredness is the feeling of wanting to sleep, and that's usually relieved by sleep, as long as your sleep is working fine, your sleep architecture is normal, and you can get refreshment from sleep. But if you feel that you need to shut your eyes to go to sleep and then get some sleep, that's very different to fatigue, which is a daily lack of energy, and that's not relieved by sleep. You may find that you wake up with minimal refreshment from sleep or no refreshment from sleep and very quickly feel that you have little energy to carry on. But the other thing that I think is important to identify is whether that that fatigue is physical or mental. Physical fatigue relates to muscle power, muscle strength, muscle weakness, a frequent side effect of corticosteroids, the inability to do prolonged physical activity, and this is really physical exhaustion that we're talking about, and that can be a big problem in sarcoidosis. But the problem that I've found from patients that I've been seeing in clinic, the absolute number one thing that if they wish they could get rid of it, it's the one thing they want to, it's the mental fatigue. It's the inability to start or complete tasks, the inability to think clearly, and the term brain fog is frequently used, and it's a very good term to describe how they feel. And trying to improve on that can be very difficult. Sometimes centers use screening tools to work out if fatigue is present or not. And this is the fatigue assessment scale tool, which is used quite commonly. And it's quite simple. It identifies symptoms which patients report commonly. It has domains which look at physical and mental exhaustion. And it's very good. But really, it's only very good when you're doing research. Because although there's a defined improvement that can be seen and there are defined thresholds for where an individual could be deemed to have fatigue or severe fatigue, actually, when it comes down to it, when you're in clinic with me, your fatigue is what you tell me it is. And if your fatigue assessment scale score is only 20 points, but you tell me that you're shattered all the time, you can't think clearly, you can't do anything, that's what I'm going to believe, and not a questionnaire score. There's multiple reasons why fatigue comes up in sarcoidosis. First, it can be directly attributed to sarcoidosis itself. It's not uncommon for someone who's having acute sarcoidosis to come to clinic, and fatigue is part of the presented complaint. Sometimes they need to go on to acute treatment because of the level of symptoms, and it can respond to things like steroids and hydroxychloroquine. But equally, steroids, particularly high doses, bring with them their own problems. And so the fatigue itself can be directly attributed to the side effects of those. And steroids wreck your sleep, make you put on weight, affect your muscle physiology and how much you can exercise. And so high doses, and as Professor Wells alluded to earlier, in the hands of the wrong poisoner, they really can be worse than the disease itself. And then finally, there's alternative causes which can occur alongside or because of sarcoidosis without being directly attributed to the granulomas that are being formed, or indeed something that's completely incidental. Patients with sarcoidosis do, after all, get other illnesses as well. And this is why in the British Thoracic Society position statement, there is a flowchart to try and allow physicians and patients to review a structured approach to how things can be reviewed. And it doesn't mean that you need to do each step in order and have to try everything before we move on to the next one, but it's a consideration of things that may or may not have a benefit for individuals, and we can roughly break it down into eliminating those alternative causes that can contribute to fatigue, and by that I mean anemia and iron deficiency, thyroid dysfunction, calcium abnormalities, and also sleep disorders, and things such as restless leg syndrome and obstructive sleep apnea are more common in sarcoidosis. And then the second half of the flowchart is to try and identify those where it's purely sarcoidosis-associated fatigue and how we might improve that. And taking that structured approach can take time. And it's important to take that time, I think, firstly, to make sure that we're not missing anything obvious, and secondly, to understand what quality of life goals we want to try and meet. And having an open discussion about those is very important. And we can then discuss, once we've gone through ruling out alternatives and seeing if there's anything that improves things from that point of view, about treatment options directly trying to target the fatigue. Now, trialing low-dose steroids with or without hydroxychloroquine is one possibility, although, as mentioned, steroids bring their own set of problems to the table, and so it's important to be frank about that. Exercise therapy and pulmonary rehabilitation, they have evidence to show that they do improve things, but the evidence is slightly biased in that there isn't really a blinded group to exercise. The patients that go into these exercise therapies go into it because they want to, and therefore it's a self-selecting group of patients that are fired up and willing to give exercise a chance and therefore most likely to benefit. But nevertheless, if you feel up to doing exercise and increasing exercise or taking part in exercise classes, they're likely to benefit you. Identifying what causes problems for you, keeping a diary of what activities have gone on in a day, when you're having bad days, when you're having good days, and then working out when to pace oneself. So someone asked me about how to better do housework without exhausting yourself, and I think this is where pacing advice does come in and come to the fore. So spreading out the various household activities across the week, roping in other halves and other people in the household to do things as much as possible, these kind of things, working out how to pace yourselves and not exhaust yourself. There is a mention of ginkgo biloba, which is a health supplement that's available from health stores and is derived from the ginkgo biloba tree, which is a Chinese tree, which is ancient and has fossils going back to 200 million years ago. There's minimal evidence from other conditions such as MS. There's not anything in sarcoidosis, but it is something that could be tried. But I'd certainly recommend discussing with your physician before you go ahead, just in case there's an interaction with other medications. And then finally, there's direct treatment with neurostimulants. This is to try and target the mental fatigue, but these are no magic bullet, and I will discuss that in just a moment. And with any treatment that's given, it's important to monitor the response closely and whether a holiday is needed. With neurostimulants, we've based the suggestion that they can be tried based on previous evidence with methylphenidate, which is a stimulant used normally in ADHD, which is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, most commonly in children, but also affects adults. It basically improves transmission of various chemicals and electrical processes through a part of the brain called the prefrontal cortex. And that's like your brain's manager. When there's not enough processes going through there, then you tend to be unable to start tasks, complete tasks, or think very clearly, which I think for some people will probably sound very familiar. And so it was tried in 5 patients as a and then reported in a single letter to a journal, and it was well tolerated and there was subjective improvement. And then it was tried again in a study in America from Cincinnati, where 10 patients were involved in a crossover study. So that meant that they got both the active drug and a placebo, and that improved the fatigue assessment scale score by an average of 5 points, more than the typical minimal clinically important difference. And then likewise, modafinil, similar study, again, similar improvement, both of these being neurostimulant medications. But the problem is, the evidence for this was crossover, so it means that patients receive the active drug and also receive placebo. And these drugs have very well or very easily identifiable side effects. So there is the risk that you unblind yourself. And so you know when you're getting the drug, and you know therefore when you're getting the placebo, and you'll report your symptoms differently as a result. And so this was a small randomized controlled trial with patients being randomized to either placebo or methylphenidate for up to a 24-week period, and then a 6-week washout. And then we looked at then the fatigue assessment scale score was measured. And lower scores here are better. The little dashed line across going horizontally is the minimum important difference. And you can see that those that were in one group, well, everyone really benefited. Mostly they came down below the minimally important difference. But the one in the dashed line group, they did better, not hugely better, but nevertheless better. And unfortunately, that group was the placebo group. And so it raises the questions about whether neurostimulants are largely acting as a placebo, with patients believing that they're going to work and therefore benefiting. I think there's more nuance to it than that. I think it's also important to mention that in that study, the placebo group became far less anxious in terms of their hospital anxiety and depression scale score during the study. And we know that anxiety affects fatigue. So that's one thing that may have impacted. But that doesn't mean that they're useless. And for some people, they do seem to make a huge difference. But I think this reinforces the importance of individualized therapy. So I think the ultimate question for those of you watching is, what can you do? And I think that looking at the video that was put together this morning, there was one person who was talking about their fatigue very eloquently, and also talking very much about what they've been able to optimize. And I think that commonly this is referred to as the common sense approach. What works for me? What can I do better? And this largely relates to sleep, diet, and exercise, making sure that you've got as good a sleep quality as possible. And that can be difficult when you're on steroids, that can be difficult when you're unwell with your sarcoid. But having a cool room, having a dark room, having regular bedtimes, having regular times of getting up, Diet, obviously eating healthily, exercise, trying to maintain levels of activity. That's been difficult in lockdown. We've seen a lot of patients who have got worse in terms of their symptoms without identifiable worsening of their sarcoidosis. So, you know, there's a lot of things that that can be improved by individuals. And also being part of the support group, I think, is hugely beneficial. But I think actively seeking out what works for you is definitely the most important thing. So I'll wrap up very quickly by saying that, going back to that original diagram, we can use immunosuppression, but it often has more risks than benefits. We can use antidepressants and neuropathic agents where pain and small fiber neuropathy is a prominent symptom. We can use neurostimulants where fatigue is the big problem, but they are not a magic bullet, and they really should be one of the options of last resort rather than anything that we should be reaching for straight off the bat. CBT, psychotherapy, talking therapies, these are all things you can self-refer to in the NHS and can have an impact on psychological impacts. Exercise and pulmonary rehab, definitely beneficial, as is pacing to make sure you don't exhaust yourself. So what to do? It's important to identify what it is that works for you, and that's equally important for you as a patient, me as a physician. Everyone has individual strategies that they respond to. Agree those treatment goals. Individualize the therapy, as multiple strategies may need to be tried or even used simultaneously. But finally, also, not everything is always due to sarcoidosis, so do keep an open mind. And that's all I have to say. I think I may have run over a little bit. I do apologize. But thank you very much for the opportunity to talk about this today. I could literally go on for hours.
Thanks for not going on for hours. Wonderful, really, really, really clear talk. Lots of very positive comments in the chat. We're not going to have a chance time for questions, unfortunately, but really a lot of the interest maybe around the small fiber neuropathy and how that explains a lot of people's symptoms. So perhaps that might be another opportunity to think about in future talks of this nature. But thank you very much, and we're grateful for your attendance. And
thank you.
Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Robina Coker, who I believe is on the call. Robina, are you with us? Can you put your camera on just so I can see? I know that Robina was just logging in. Robina, you are here. I can't see you on the screen, that's all. You pop your camera on. Okay. At the bottom on the stop video. So what we, Robina, I can see you on the chat. If it's proving challenging for now, I think Lisa's very kindly agreed to go first, if you would prefer. If you just put me a message on the chat to let me know, that would be very helpful. Okay, Leo, would you mind touching base with Robina and helping her with her video function? I think there's a problem with that. And Lisa Spencer, if you're okay to jump on. Perfect, thank you. While Robina is getting her camera sorted, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Lisa Spencer, a good friend, and she is giving us a talk on the British Thoracic Society response to the pandemic. Lisa's got a very senior position in the British Thoracic Society as Honorary Secretary. She's been involved in the registry, I think, from inception up until recently, and continues to be highly active, representing the ILD and sarcoidosis community at the highest levels of NHS England and beyond. So thank you, Lisa. We're very much looking forward to your talk.
Hi, Pete. Just bear with me one second. I'm just having a slight issue sharing my screen for some reason. We tested it earlier and it worked fine. Let me just... Right, hopefully. That's working now. Okay, and you can hear me.
You can. If you just click on the presenter view, then we'll be able to... That's it. Perfect. Thank you.
Are we okay there? Yeah, sorry, I was just not prepared with the screen sharing there. Okay, sorry about that little glitch. Thank you, Pete, for that very generous introduction. Hello to everyone. It's really, really lovely to be here today. I've managed to dip in and out a bit because I had some of the commitments today, but what a fantastic day. so far. It's been really good. So hello to all the patients out there. And I would like to thank Leo and Dr. Kouranos and the Sarcoidosis Charity for the kind invite to come and talk to you today. So I think what Dr. Kouranos wanted me to touch upon today was some of the work that your lung healthcare professionals have been doing in the background that may have been slightly unseen. So they wanted me to do something around the British Thoracic Society, which is our medical specialist society for lung healthcare professionals. And talk about our response to the pandemic and obviously try and focus that in a bit on interstitial lung disease. So what is the British Thoracic Society? Many of you may not be that aware of it. So it's a registered charity with members, and those members consist of respiratory doctors, nurses, physiotherapists, physiologists. Those are the healthcare professionals that take you through your breathing tests, and also scientists and other people that are interested in respiratory care. The aim of the British Thoracic Society is fairly clear. I think it's about championing excellence in diagnosis, treatment and care of people with all lung diseases, and also in those who are delivering it. And the BTS is intrinsically involved with training respiratory professionals in the exam setting, delivering exams, and driving up standards of care. So we have a programme of guidelines and guidance that we produce every so often for diseases. And this allows a good standard of care amongst the respiratory professionals, but also people from other specialities can take those guidelines and apply them and give good respiratory care outside of their specialist area in an easy manner. We encourage support research. And we also deliver two respiratory conferences each year where we share information and hopefully improve knowledge. So I had to sort of sit back and have a think when I got this title of this talk as to really what to focus on. The BTS does a lot of stuff normally in non-COVID times, but it's been extremely busy, as you can imagine, during COVID. So I've made this brief list of things that I think are ILD sort of specific, and there's four things here that I'm going to run through about things that I think made a difference to ILD care. I just remind that when I say ILD, that incorporates sarcoidosis. Sarcoidosis, as you'll know, is a form of interstitial lung disease and covers many diseases. So one of the things that we did a lot of website guidance, and in particular, we provided quite early on a document for the care that we thought would be best delivered for ILD patients within the pandemic. And this was put together by a number of ILD specialists and specialist centres, a number of collaborators put that document together. We also took that to the next level and we published national guidance about ILD management, which went out on the NICE website. So I know we've got some overseas participants today, so you may not be familiar what NICE is. NICE is the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, which is a body that covers care in England and Wales, and it's there to ensure standards of care and improve care within the NHS. And it's a very well trusted and respected body, so to get guidance on their website is very helpful to getting the word about what's going on. We also got national agreement quite early on with respiratory colleagues to prioritise actually interstitial lung disease patients, sarcoidosis patients, to have access to breathing tests. Some of you may or may not know, but the lab shut down for a while, causing problems and backlog. So that was good that we got that access agreed early. And I think the other important thing that we did is we took action early to protect ILD patients by adding them to shielding lists. Now, again, if you're joining us from abroad, you might not be aware about what shielding is. I think it was a bit of a UK thing, the terminology. And I'll come on to that and some of these points a bit more as we go through the slides. So what about website guidance? Obviously, I've mentioned we had an interstitial lung disease document, but actually, like many other medical specialist societies, when COVID hit, we had to open up a web portal and a hub for information. Of course, because COVID is primarily a respiratory problem, everybody was wanting to know information and wanting it from the respiratory people. So over a very short period of time, weeks, we produced about 30 pieces of guidance, and it was no mean feat. And initially, it was a very small number of us at the BTS that were leading on this. And then as time went by, we managed to get more people involved, and some of our specialist advisory group members who have got experts on helped put some of these documents together. And you have to remember that this was happening while the first COVID surge was going on. So all our respiratory colleagues were either working extra shifts, extra on calls, and were absolutely hammered at the time. And they were doing these things at night, weekends, under great pressure, and it's a real credit that they got some of this work out there. I remember this first period of COVID as being one of the worst of my life, and being very, very tired with all the things that we were having to do. So people did really well to get all that stuff out there. The documents are quite widespread, actually. We cover certain diseases and how they should be managed during COVID. Things like procedures. How can you do a bronchoscopy where we put telescopes into lungs to get samples and things? How can you do that safely in a COVID environment? There's a lot of aerosol generation, people coughing. How do you do that safely without harming the patient, harming the staff? Also, procedures like lung function tests. How can you do those safely? We need to get our evidence out there to keep our patients safe, to keep our staff safe. Needed the staff to be at work to look after all the patients. Also extended out into the community. So a lot of our airways patients with COPD and asthma managed actually a lot in the community, and we needed to extend our advice out into their care as well to make sure that everyone was looked after properly. We also had to collaborate very closely with other specialist societies, particularly, for example, the Intensive Care Society. These patients were ill with a respiratory breathing problem. They might start on a medical or a chest ward. They might transit into intensive care, transit back out. We had to agree between us what were the right points that we would escalate their care or de-escalate their care. And we had to ensure that guidance that was coming out from different medical specialities was saying the same thing. We didn't want one specialist society to say one thing and one another. For example, around sarcoidosis patients, a lot of patients might be on drugs that suppress their immune system. And we had to link in with societies like rheumatology, who use a lot of these drugs, because we didn't want to give the rheumatology patients different advice to the sarcoid patients, because it would have been extremely confusing for patients. And also, we wanted to give clear messages where possible. So there was a lot of back chat and information sharing going on, and also talking to the charities. You know, where there was patient information coming out, we wanted to get that out through the charity avenues, because the charities have been amazing supporting patients and getting information, accurate information out to patients. So there has been a lot going on. Just early on, just to give you a couple of examples, I remember very early on, one of the first sort of controversies we had was, is it safe for people to have a nebulizer if they might have COVID? And of course, initially, swabs took a long time to go back. We didn't know whether patients had COVID or not, and we put them in different areas. So on the top right of the slide, there's a picture there of a nebulizer mask with a sort of mist coming out of it, which is the nebulized drug. Mm-hmm. Nebulizers look different, but there's a chamber underneath where you put the liquid drug, and then the tubing goes to a machine that pushes air through, nebulizes the drug into this aerosol, and it makes it very easy for patients to inhale it. Now, most commonly, that sort of drug will be used actually for asthma or COPD perhaps, and those nebulizers can be life-saving treatment. But you can imagine, if you think someone's got COVID and there's all this steam coming off their face, and at the time we were worried, we didn't know how COVID was spread, were we putting COVID virus particles all over the A&E area or all over the ward? There was a lot of controversy and questions and worry, understandably. So we were actually, in the end, we were quite quickly able to put that myth that it was dangerous to give nebulizers and it would spread COVID to bed. But if we hadn't have hit on that and got that sorted out earlier, people would not have got drugs that they need that could be life-saving. Another example is over the use of CPAP. That stands for continuous positive airway pressure. And the bottom picture on the right is a picture of a circuit of face masks going into a yellow sort of oval shaped filter down to some oxygen tubing and some tubing to a machine. This is a sort of typical setup that we might use to give CPAP, which we are very familiar with as chest physicians. We used it for a long time for people with sleep apnea to help them sleep better, but we were using it now to deliver oxygen, and that wasn't done very commonly before, and certainly outside of chest units it wasn't really done by anyone else. So, but the patients with COVID weren't just sitting on chest wards, they were sitting on medical wards, and sometimes they were being looked after by non-respiratory doctors or surgical teams with physicians paired up. So these are the teams who were not familiar with these circuits, how to keep them safe, how important it was to put this extra bacterial filter that we don't normally use in the community outside of COVID. These filters will stop the disbursement of viral particles. So, you know, we had our own patients to look after. We were also outreaching to other teams, supporting, checking that patients on these pieces of equipment were safe. And that guidance we were putting out was very important for lung doctors to check what was right, and also for non-lung doctors to make sure they were doing the right thing. So I have no doubt in my mind that some of the advice that we about it makes things safer and it saves some lives. And so that's very important. And you might wonder, well, was it used? Was it accessed? Did anyone listen? Did anyone read it? Well, we've got some data now from 13th of March 2020 through to March 2021. And our systems tell us that we've had 345,000 views of these documents now. We've had over 280,000 downloads. That's around 1,000 visits a day to our website and 750 downloads per day. This is, traffic is huge compared to the normal sort of traffic we get pre-COVID. It's a wonder that some of the websites and the internet didn't crash at points. And actually, if only 10% of those downloads helped a clinician and their patients, the BTS there, if only 10% was helpful, helped 28,000 clinicians during that year. So it was a massive amount of work. Moving on, I mentioned that we got an escalation of our guidance, not just on our website. We got it out with a NICE guideline. During COVID-19, NICE has produced 36, approximately, I think, rapid guidelines across many disease areas, across all of medicine. A fifth of those guidelines have had significant respiratory input, obviously, because of the disease. And so we've had a lot of input into a lot of guidance around interstitial lung disease, different diseases like asthma, COPD, cystic fibrosis. And again, this was all done when respiratory doctors were under a lot of pressure. So, you know, it wasn't easy to do. Why is it important to get these documents out? Why doesn't just our website? Well, it's important because it reaches a wider audience. People can access the information. They will use the NICE website for reliable information. And importantly, I think for interstitial lung disease, as I've highlighted in red here, we managed to get into this document about something about shielding. I'll come to shielding in a minute. But it was quite controversial shielding. And as many of you will know, interstitial lung disease was not on the original shielding list, which caused quite some problems for me and all our colleagues, as you can imagine. But we got a mention about shielding in here. And this was the first sort of public national document. We got it in and got it written in. I think that was an important step forward. We also made it clear in this document that ILD centres were open for business. We were still there to see patients who were getting ill and needed urgent, rapid treatment. We could still see patients face to face if it was important to do so. So we made that clear in this document, and that went out there. We talked about blood monitoring and how GPs could help with that, and GPs were great. They helped with the community blood monitoring. We also mentioned things like home spirometry, which wasn't really documented anywhere else apart from on our website, that it was okay to use this to monitor patients where needed so the patient could remain at home and remain safe but still have assessment of their condition. And interestingly, when I was reading it the other night, we put quite a little bit in about not stopping steroids and not stopping immunosuppression on our patients. And at the time, that was actually quite controversial because we know now steroids are good for COVID most of the time. But back then, people were worried that they would harm people. And actually, we got that into this document as well. So don't stop the drugs unless you've got a good reason. And that may, in retrospect, have been a very sensible decision. I mentioned about us getting priority for ILD patients to get access to breathing tests. You may or may not have been aware, but when the initial shutdown happened in the UK, where everything shut down, our labs shut down completely as well. We had no access to breathing tests. And this is because in the early phases, it was felt that doing breathing tests would be an aerosol generating procedure, an AGP, another word that's come into our vocabulary since COVID, along with other strange words that we use now. So this means that because patients cough often during a breathing test, that we know that coughing can release COVID into the air, and that was considered to be a risk. It might make the room infected with virus, if you like, and it might infect the staff. So we had to, when things were shut down, we had to then make everything very COVID safe, COVID secure, to reopen those labs and get the tests going. So there was a backlog where no lab service was available. And then once it reopened, because to make it COVID secure, we had to do a lot of air changes, leave time between the room, clean the machines. All that took time, and there are less slots. But we managed to agree with our colleagues, who were very supportive, that to start treatment, stop treatment, and change treatment ILD, it was important that we got the access to the lab tests. We were second in line to cancer, which is for obvious reason. Cancer services did continue as much as they could. But then we got the next access to ILD, to breathing tests, which I think was very important. And so far as I'm aware, there's been no outbreaks through labs. And just so you know, breathing into the machines don't get anything inside them. They don't get infected with virus because there's lots of filters and things. The machines are quite safe. This is about cleaning down the outside of the machine, cleaning the room, which is all in place. And we've had no outbreaks, which has been immense credit to our lab staff. Shielding, I mentioned briefly before. So we know in the UK, ILD patients weren't named. Other respiratory diseases were named. A lot of controversy, which I don't have time to cover really, but there was a lack of communication perhaps between the chief medical officer and the specialist societies, at least that's our perception. And this led to perhaps some diseases that should have been in there were left off. But what we managed to do is we managed through the ILD community to contact all the specialist centres and get letters sent out to our patients. In Liverpool alone, I had to send out over a few days 2,700 patients letters from my clinic. And at the time, we had no administration staff because they were either sick or diverted elsewhere. Doctors and nurses were all busy on the ward. It was hard to do, but we did it. Some people may feel that we overprotected patients, but there was an opportunity to review their shielding status and unshield them if necessary later. Shielding is important because for those who might not know about it, perhaps those of you who are listening in from abroad, it permits access to support networks, get people helping you to get your shopping in whilst you're staying inside. It can also give you protection against being sent into an unsafe workplace for you. It can be difficult though, obviously the isolation and the mental health issues you get with it can be very tricky. Hurrah, shielding ended yesterday. This is a good thing because obviously we're moving forward and getting away from the serious end of the pandemic now, we hope. That is also though going to cause some anxiety because people might have to look at whether they can go back to work, which involves discussions with your human resources department, occupational medicine input, but a very nervous time for patients. Just a quick news flash, I don't know whether you're aware, shielding meant as well, of course, that patients got early access to the vaccine, which has been a good thing, I think, for our patients. If you hadn't been on a shielding list, that wouldn't have happened. You'd have to wait turn sarcoidosis patients often in the younger end and would have waited much longer. This is a news flash. This has come out 2 days ago, and I suspect people may not be aware of it yet, but it's important for sarcoidosis because a significant number of sarcoid patients will be on immunosuppression. You are now able to access early vaccination for your partner, family, carers, household contacts over the age of 16. We don't know how you get that access yet. They've not told us that. But who lives with you will be able to get vaccinated earlier to protect you. So that's a bit of a newsflash item. This, I think, is virtually my last slide. This isn't a COVID thing, but many people have talked about the BTS clinical statement on pulmonary sarcoidosis today and how that's going to hopefully improve care. It wasn't done during COVID, it got published during COVID. And I just mention it as something else that we're doing around sarcoidosis. And also just to mention, I don't have any time left to talk about it. Pete's about to switch me off, tell me my time's up. We do run a national sarcoidosis registry. And I hope, all I say is I hope in the future it plays a bigger role in improving care. This is my last slide. Just to acknowledge, COVID has been a nightmare for practically everyone. Here's some colleagues here who are wearing PPE, another word that we wouldn't have known in the past. We're all pretty sick of COVID, I think. So here's my attempt to cheer things up. This was me working on Christmas Day, trying to cheer everyone up. But I think I'm scaring people, actually. And I'd just like to say thank you to everyone. Sorry, getting emotional, I don't know why. Thanks to everyone who's worked really hard. And to all my respiratory colleagues, sorry about that.
Lisa, that was a wonderful talk. And actually, after you've had a glass of water, you should go and have a look back at the chat and see just how much.
I couldn't follow it.
Have a look at it afterwards and have a look at just how much the work that you and other members of the BTS did really for the community, for the patients, but also for us as consultants and healthcare workers in the area. So we're very grateful. We're actually really grateful for all that work and for your talk. So thank you.
Yeah, sorry about that. I wasn't expecting that. It was seeing all the staff again. Sorry about that.
Thank you so much, Lisa. We're very grateful. And do have a look back through that chat. I think you'll enjoy it. It's a nice read.
Okay. Are we doing questions? Or are we moving on?
Move on, Lisa, just in the interest of time.
Okay.
We had a list of about 20 questions and you managed to hit them all through your presentation. So everything that was asked, you actually answered.
Brilliant. Okay, I'll switch off then now. Thanks very much.
Yeah. Thank you. And Robina, I think I just saw your video on.
Yes, thank you, Pete. You should be able to see me. Do you want me to share my screen?
Yes, that's perfect. Dr. Robina Coker is a consultant respiratory physician at Imperial College NHS Trust. She runs the sarcoid service at the Hammersmith, a large service. Got very senior roles, not just within her trust, but also within the region. She's the clinical director for the NIHR, reference CRN, Northwest London. It's a lot of abbreviations. I'm getting tongue-tied even though I'm part of it, so that's embarrassing. But I'd like to pass over to Robina. You're going to tell us all about COVID-19 and sarcoid, and what's changed with regard to risk and benefit in management and monitoring. So thank you, Robina.
Thank you very much, Pete, and I'd like to thank the organisers of this symposium very much for inviting me, and it's a real pleasure to be with you this afternoon, and I'm sorry I had to join you a little late. So I've been asked to talk about COVID-19 and sarcoidosis, and despite Pete's warm words, I doubt that I'm going to be able to answer all your questions, but I will do the best I can with the data that we have at the moment. And right through this talk, I'm going to try and think about what we should or could have done differently, perhaps, or perhaps we wouldn't have done anything differently. What can we be doing now, and what might we do differently in the future? And I'm going to touch on some of the amazing work that Lisa Spencer, whom you've just heard, did with the BTS, which undoubtedly made a huge difference to all of us. And it has been a very, very difficult time, but there are some things we might take forward and we might hold on to. So we'll talk about some of those in a few minutes. And I've tried to address some of your questions. I'm really grateful to those of you who've put questions in, submitted questions in advance. They're really good questions. And I'm not sure I've covered all of them, but I've tried to cover as many as possible. So I was asked to talk about risk and then changes in management and monitoring. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the risk of people with sarcoidosis catching COVID. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about the risk of serious illness when you've caught COVID. And of course, this time last year, we were very much focused on the risk of acute illness. But we know now that many people have longer-term symptoms, what we now call long COVID. So I'm going to touch on that as well. And then I'm going to think about changes in management last year, this year and beyond next year. And I'm going to talk about monitoring as well as part of all that. So in terms of the risk of catching COVID, there's really no evidence or rationale for an increased risk of catching COVID just because you have sarcoidosis, unless, of course, you are immunosuppressed, and that is the risk. So if you're on immunosuppressant medication, that will make anyone, including anyone with sarcoidosis, more susceptible to any infection, including COVID-19. And this was the basis of the UK shielding advice this time last year, which initially included people on immunosuppression. But as Lisa mentioned, it was the BTS really that moved the goalposts and said, actually, we should be including all patients with ILD and sarcoidosis. And that was at the end of March last year. And I'm sure this was definitely the right thing to do. We were very worried about many of our patients, and you'll see why in a few moments. So what about the risk of severe acute illness? Well, as early 2020, really, so before the lockdown in the UK, it was very clear from the data that were emerging from Wuhan that there was a greater risk of serious illness with COVID and indeed mortality if you had certain pre-existing conditions, and those included established lung disease, and the headline lung diseases were COPD and asthma. But not surprisingly, there was nothing about ILD really. And the data are still very limited. Geezy Jenkins and a number of us published this international multi-center study of over 160 patients with ILD in the Blue Journal at the end of last year. And that showed a higher mortality in patients with interstitial lung disease or parenchymal lung disease, so changes on CT, compared with matched controls. But you can see here that there were only 9 patients with sarcoidosis. The numbers are really very small, unsurprisingly. And there was a worse outcome linked to male gender, impaired lung function, and obesity. And the impaired lung function is the important thing to note here, because that's going to come up again. The poorer survival in these groups was associated with patients who had a diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, followed by chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis and rheumatoid associated interstitial lung disease. And actually those with sarcoidosis had the lowest mortality in those groups. But remember, again, very small numbers, so it's quite difficult to draw any conclusions. And then there was a New York study of over 7,000 patients with just 37 sarcoidosis patients. And that showed that a diagnosis of sarcoidosis didn't predict a worse outcome. It wasn't associated with a worse outcome, but it was a worse outcome was associated with a moderate to severe impairment of lung function, whether you measured it with spirometry or gas transfer in the last 3 years. So that really does seem to suggest that impaired lung function is important. And then in terms of immunosuppression, and as Lisa's alluded to, we were very worried initially about continuing patients on steroids. And in fact, I had phone calls from surrounding hospitals quite a lot during the first 4 weeks saying, we've just admitted one of your patients, should we stop their steroids? And I said, no, don't stop their steroids. But it was a slight act of faith at the time. I felt, for the reasons I'll discuss later, that it was important not to stop them. But nobody quite knew, and there was a lot of anxiety about steroids. Anyway, a retrospective North American cohort study of over 2,000 patients in hospital with COVID, and that was published earlier this year, showed they had a 5% were immunosuppressed. And that showed that those immunosuppressed patients didn't have worse outcomes in terms of length of stay, risk of progressing to invasive ventilation, so CPAP or intubation, or indeed mortality. So that's quite reassuring insofar as it goes. And then what about the risk of long COVID? Very limited data so far. And NICE published a review of long COVID in December. And in terms of risk factors, they looked at 13 studies and they noted that the data were quite low quality. That's not surprising, of course. They were gathered quickly and during a pandemic, which made it very difficult to do. And the studies were often small. And there were a very wide range of risk factors that were identified. And the NICE reviewers felt that the risk of bias was really quite high or medium at best. And so they felt they were unable to draw firm conclusions on possible risk factors for long COVID, and the evidence they'd gathered was not generalizable to the entire population. But of course, one of the reasons they did this was because they didn't want to exclude anybody from long COVID clinics or access to support. And they emphasized it's important to monitor anyone with symptoms of long COVID, regardless of whether they're perceived to have been at particular risk of long COVID. So that's a bit on risk. What about change in management? So last year, the headlines were the shielding advice, and Lisa's talked very eloquently about that. Some of you may have been to hospital because urgent hospital visits were regarded as essential travel, quite correctly. And the BTS advice, and I think it was absolutely the right advice, and it was what we were doing on the ground, was to advise patients to stay on their current medication if they were stable. And the aim was very much to use the lowest dose of immunosuppression to control the condition. And I actually think that is good practice anyway. It's what we should always be doing. But certainly being in the middle of a pandemic focused the mind on that. And there was a very understandable and I think justifiable reluctance to increase immunosuppression or start new agents unless it was absolutely necessary. And so we had to assess everyone on an individual case by case basis. And again, I would say that is the correct approach normally and is part of good clinical practice. And then of course, towards the end of last year, there was a wider rollout of the seasonal influenza vaccine, which may have impacted some of you here today. What about changes in monitoring? Well, most hospitals, if not all, very quickly moved to remote consultations, particularly during the first and second waves, either telephone and in some cases video. Lisa's alluded to the fact that the lung function laboratories were almost completely closed. A lot of that was due to the risk, as she's talked about, of aerosol generation through the procedures that we do in lung function, where we make you cough and blow hard. But of course, the other thing is that the respiratory physiology staff are highly skilled. And in our case, certainly, many of them, if not all of them, were redeployed to ICU and acute respiratory units to help manage those. So it was a double whammy, really, in terms of lung function. And that's why it's been so difficult and it's taken such a long time to get lung function restarted. We had reduced imaging capacity, and many of you will have been aware of that because you may have had tests cancelled. And that was partly the demands from the COVID cases, because every patient needed a chest x-ray and many of them needed CT scans. But also, of course, because of infection control measures, including social distancing. So that just meant you couldn't have as many people in the department as once. You had to make appointments, you had to keep people apart, and you had to clean the facilities more thoroughly than you would have done previously between each patient. So that just meant we couldn't fit in as many people. On a more positive side, I think we made, in many cases, better use of community blood testing or phlebotomy. And some of you may have had recourse to home tests, such as spirometry or blood tests, and that was very much up to community resources, facilities, clinician preference, patient preference, and so on. But there were some changes that some of you may have been aware of. terms of management this year, of course, the big headline are the vaccines. We now have three approved in the UK. And I want to emphasise this incredible success, this headline figure of 82 to 95% protection against severe illness. And I want just to reflect on that, because we should really be celebrating and congratulating the people who've worked so hard on that. When I did a seminar for, or a video for Sarcoidosis UK in December with Anna Blackney, I well remember her beautiful Christmas tree. She's a scientist who was working at Imperial College London, has now moved to Canada to set up her own lab. She told us that Pfizer, remember Pfizer, an American company with stretch targets, an eye on the bottom line, in April, April 2020, they set a target of 70% protection against COVID for their vaccine. So they would have been delighted if they'd had 70%. They've ended up with 95%, and that's a figure that's unbelievably good. So these are really effective vaccines. And the influenza vaccine, by contrast, has around 50% efficacy. But we don't agonize every year about whether it's worth having the flu vaccine. We do recommend it. So I'd just like to say what a wonderful achievement that was. And I know some of you have quite understandable concerns about whether the vaccines are safe if you're immunocompromised. There's no live virus in the vaccines, so they are safe for immunocompromised patients. We recommend every year that our immunosuppressed patients have the flu vaccine. And the flu vaccine has no live virus in it. The efficacy may be lower. There are studies showing that the influenza vaccine is less effective if you're on methotrexate or rituximab, but we still recommend it. And I'll come on later to say, to point this out, but of course, if you've got 95% protection as a headline figure, we would hope that you would get protection, even if you're immunosuppressed, even if that efficacy is a bit lower. And of course, over 30 million now in the UK have now received their first dose, which is an amazing achievement. As Lisa mentioned, the UK shielding advice ended yesterday. Many of you will be very delighted about that, I'm sure. I would just touch on travel advice for the future. A number of my patients are hoping to travel. Please remember that it won't just be the UK government advice on holidays that we have to take into account. It will be the prevalence of COVID cases overseas. We're seeing what's happening in France at the moment. And of course, the presence of new variants. And some of those variants may be relatively resistant to vaccines. It should be perfectly possible to tweak the vaccines, but it may require a booster in the autumn. So we just got to be a little bit cautious about planning our holidays just yet, I think. In terms of changes in monitoring 2021 and beyond, I foresee that certainly for the moment, there's likely to be a hybrid model of consultations. I think we've shown that remote visits, in inverted commas, do offer convenience. You can often have a consultation with your doctor in the comfort of your own home. You don't have to travel to the hospital. You don't have to spend half an hour trying to find a car parking space and then find that the car parking machine either doesn't accept your credit card or you don't have enough cash. And of course, we've also shown that for many patients with long-standing respiratory conditions, there's a much lower risk from respiratory infection if we all stay apart a little bit. So that's a benefit. But of course, remote consultation is not always suitable. Not everybody finds it easy to use the telephone. And it's difficult to build up that rapport that you need if you're managing a long-term condition, I think, if you never see the person at the other end of the telephone. So I suspect there will be a mix, not least because we still want to keep our waiting rooms from becoming overcrowded, because we know that will increase the risk of community transmission, not just of COVID, but of everything. And I would hope that we can build better shared care with our community services. Many of our general practitioners have been fantastic in terms of offering local blood services and so on. And for many of you, that may be much more convenient than coming to the hospital. Changes in management, looking to 2022 and beyond. I think the recommendations on immunosuppression are likely to continue. And as I say, I think that makes sense and that's good clinical practice. Some trusts are using cloud technology to help store personal health information and allow you, the patient, to access your health records on your smartphone at any time, so you can have your scans and your letters and your blood test results available, and you can share that information with whoever you wish to. You can upload your own information. I think both with remote consultations and the increasing use of technology, it's really important that we build up good patient-clinician partnerships, because this has to be done in partnership with you, the patient. We need to know what you want, what works for you, and it needs to be tailored to your needs. Clinical research is absolutely vital. Pete's alluded to my role within the NIHR. I'm the clinical director for Northwest London Clinical Research Network. We led on the REMAP CAP study, which showed that dexamethasone reduced mortality significantly in seriously ill patients with COVID. We supported the recovery trial, and we've shown how important it is. So it absolutely needs to continue. And we need to think about taking part in research as part of our taking part in our receiving NHS care. You know, what can we do? What can we contribute? And we heard a lot about long COVID from Chris earlier. Heard a lot about fatigue in sarcoidosis from Chris earlier. And I'm really hopeful that some of the research into long COVID will give us a better understanding of sarcoidosis, and particularly strategies to manage fatigue, because it's been very difficult to do studies in fatigue in sarcoidosis. And you know, there is funding now for research into long COVID, and I think it's being taken seriously. So I'm optimistic and hopeful that actually we might understand more about fatigue in sarcoidosis as a result of long COVID. So what have we learned in summary? We know that immunosuppression increases the risk of catching COVID, but it doesn't appear to be linked to a worse outcome, which is encouraging. We've learned that significantly impaired lung function, perhaps unsurprisingly, does appear to be linked to worse outcomes. Would we give the shielding advice again in the future? Yes, I think we would. I think it was the right thing to do. We had an unknown virus. We had it circulating at very high levels in the community. We had an absence of comprehensive testing or tracing, so we couldn't be sure where it was. We couldn't manage outbreaks. And I think it was the best way to protect people in the circumstances. It's possible that you could refine it with what we know now. And it's quite likely, of course, and I don't want to be to sound too pessimistic, but it's perfectly conceivable that we will have another pandemic in the next decade or 20 years. And of course, a different virus might behave differently. So we just need to be cautious about assuming that all viruses will behave like COVID. Encouragingly, I think because of the very high efficacy of vaccines, they're likely to confer some protection in immunosuppressed patients, which I think is great. We've learned that remote consultations can be effective. We've learned that all these measures, which we find rather burdensome, like social distancing and hand washing and masks and remote consultations, they are effective in reducing the transmission of common respiratory infections. And that's definitely going to affect how we review people in future and how we hold those consultations. The use of technology is going to increase, I think, exponentially. The NHS has demonstrated it can move quickly if it needs to. But again, engagement with yourselves, the patients, and community services will be absolutely vital for that to work. And clinical research is a lifeline. And I just want to thank everyone, every patient out there, and anyone else who's listening, who's taken part in clinical research during this time. You have made a difference. And I'd really encourage you, if you haven't taken part, find something to take part in. If you want antibody testing, go and find a study where they're doing antibody testing. You can make a difference. And we've shown that it's a really important way to develop our knowledge, the only way to develop our knowledge about management of important conditions. So thank you.
That was another real masterclass, actually. And once again, you've gone through everything that everybody wanted to know. There isn't a question left that hasn't been covered, even in the chat, which you didn't know was going on. So that was perfect. And I'm really grateful to you. I'm grateful to all the speakers who have given up their time to speak in this last session. I think it's been a really, really comprehensive session. It's really hit the full breadth of what we wanted to know about the most challenging aspects of managing patients with sarcoidosis and patients understanding, I hope, more about the challenges of their condition and how to drive forward their care in a way that allows them to be very much at the centre of everything that happens to them. And I'd like to echo Robina's final point about the importance of clinical research and how each one of us can be an individual that is part of a very strong team in improving outcomes for people with these conditions. And the conversation about fatigue and long COVID is a particularly interesting one, which has got a number of times in the chat. So thank you for addressing that, Robina. There is a 7-minute break. It's now a 6-minute break. So I will let you all go and get a coffee. I'd like to thank you all for staying on this long. And we've got a very exciting session on clinicians and patients' experience and future research aims next. Okay, thank you all. Bye-bye.